Hello, everyone. I want to take a brief look at round 7 from the Grenca Chess Classic. This game is between a world champion Magnus Carlsen with the white pieces and Levon Aronian with the black pieces. So let's get right into it. I'm not going to go into any deep analysis. This game has already been covered during the actual game by Lako and Gustafsson, amongst other GMs. But what I am going to do is break it down. And just go over some general ideas in the position. So we have d4, knight f6 by Aronian, c4, e6. Okay, so offering Nimzo-Indian possibility. Magnus declines that. Black can go into a Queen's Indian, but you don't see that too often nowadays. B6, it's one of those old moves from the Karpov-Kasparov era. And so instead of trying to force things with Bishop B4, which would be a Bogo Indian, Aronian just simply plays D5, and now we transpose into a Queen's Gambit decline. Knight C3, and D takes C4. Now it's like a Queen's Gambit accepted position. And now after E4, Bishop B4, we transpose into the Rogozin defense. Bishop g5, attacking White's perfect center, which must be done. B takes c4, and now c takes d4. Knight takes d4, and now Black parts ways with the bishop in order to weaken the e4 square and White's pawn structure in general. So he gives up his bishop, just like in the Nimzo-Indian. B takes c3, check. B takes c3, and now queen a5, attacking c3 and the bishop on g5 at the same time. So the bishop retreats. Here, let me just say briefly, as a general idea, for that people, at lower chess levels, lower than master, can follow, is basically what does what does White have here, in compensation for his deteriorated pawn structure? Well, he has the bishop here, which is very good. As you can see, he has his light and dark square bishops. He has more space on the board. Notice White's occupying the first four ranks, and with his pawns, and Black is only occupying the first three ranks. All right, he has greater control and influence in the center right now, as he's able to have his piece posted on d4. He has his pawn on e4. Notice that pawn is a little weak right now, but his pawn is on e4, which prevents Black from using the d5 and f5 square. All right, and beside that, he also has two open files, the b file and the d file. And he has a lead in development, and this is because of the early movement of the black queen in the position. So this is what White has in compensation for his deteriorated pawn structure. On the other hand, Black wants to rely on a solid pawn structure, and his plan is going to be based on the static weaknesses of White in the position. Of course, he wants to continue to challenge the weak pawn on e4. The c th on c3, he wants to attack down the c file and put pressure on that weak pawn. And along the way, he wants to slowly consolidate, trade off White's pieces, and try to stake his claim in the ending. So White's game is based more on dynamism. Right, using the open files, the long range attacking power of the two bishops, right, his space in the center to be able to push Black off the board. So he's relying on more present and dynamic features in order to dictate the play in his game, where Black is trying to keep things calm. Right, trade off pieces and then use his pristine pawn structure to push his point later on. And so this is like the general strategy that these players will be following here. Aronian castles. Now, he could have took the pawn. It gets very sharp, though. Not saying it's bad. It seems kind of equal, but it gets very sharp. After knight takes e4, queen g4, attacking the knight and the pawn on g7. Knight takes d2, queen takes g7, knight takes c4, queen takes h8, check, king e7, castles, knight d7, rook fe1, knight f8, rook ad1, bishop d7, rook d3, queen g5, and now knight f3 with a very double-edged position here. This is the type of position that you do not want to go into, especially as black, if you're not prepared for it. And after knight f3, black can play a move like queen f5 or perhaps queen c5 here. But as you can see, it's a sharp position, and Aronian probably didn't want to go into something like that, especially if he's just trying to keep things calm, like we talked about earlier. So instead, he castled, which is perfectly acceptable. Now Magnus protects the e-pawn, and now Aronian gains some space and stakes his claim in the center now with e5. So now the game is pretty equal. Both sides again have their general plans. Like I said, black is playing for the more static advantages in the position, and white is playing in a dynamic fashion, and of course doesn't really want to trade pieces. So he plays knight b3, harassing the queen. Another option would be knight f5. Again, this would give black opportunity to just chop off some pieces. So knight f5, bishop takes f5, e takes, knight bd7, castles, rook ac8, rook fd1, the other rook comes out. And say rook ab1, attacking the b pawn, and then again a move like queen c7 with a double attack on the bishop here, or even queen c5 or queen c7. In the game, it'll be equal here, and black has nothing to worry about here, and white still has to prove his point in the position. But as long as white has those two bishops and a good piece play, that's enough compensation for his dilapidated pawn structure. So knight b3 took place. Aronian played queen c7, castles, and now bishop g4, f3, and now some tactics. Rook c8. Again, Aronian wants to trade pieces. Bishop d5, so now he plays knight takes d5, e takes d5. Now the bishop drops back, and this gives Magnus a chance to play the move c4. So again, he has improved his pawn structure somewhat, and he has some more space. And now this d6 pawn is a passed pawn, and black will have to keep his eye on that pawn for the rest of the game. Okay. Knight d7. Again, for you new people, if he tries to get greedy and take the pawn, then just simply rook fc1 or rook a c1 wins right on the spot due to the weakness on the back rank here. So, for example, queen takes, and then just rook takes. There's no avoiding that. So for example, he tries to move out the way, then it's just mate. Rook takes c8. And two, actually. Rook takes c8, queen e8, and then capture the queen. So you get the point there. So knight d7. Now the rook comes over. Rook fc1, b6. This fixes the c4 pawn. a4. Here's an important decision by Aronian. Because if he doesn't stop white with a5 himself, then white will play a5. For instance, he could have did a move like queen d6 here, but then allow a5 So he plays a5 himself. And now queen f2. And black, excuse me, white tries to focus on this weakness right here. Queen d6. Bishop e3. And now bishop g6. Magnus goes to d2. F6, and fortifying the e5 pawn. Queen b2, rook to c7, and white has his own weaknesses here, as well as here, which black is focused on. Knight d2, and now the knight hops into c5. Good square. And here's a good move by Magnus. This is kind of annoying because the queen is hanging here, so this knight can't really move around. So now rook d8, protecting the queen. Rook c3 from Magnus. And now here is where I believe Aronian makes his first major error in the game. One thing I noticed watching the game is that Magnus is always ahead in time. So Magnus plays rook c3, and here Aronian presses forward with f5. The problem with this move is that the black's e pawn will now come under attack and will be very difficult to protect here. So in hindsight, he probably should have opted out with the move like rook b8 and basically did nothing. Right, all the white's pawns are blockaded, and black only really has to worry about the b6 pawn, which he has adequately protected. And this probably would have ended in some kind of perpetual. So, for instance, knight b3, and now knight b7. And that's one option if black played rook b8. Another option is rook b7. Again, moves that don't really commit too much, but don't damage the position. So knight b3, rook c8. Say some exchanges took place. And again, after say like a move like a5, for example, just take. And black seems to be fine here also. Just has to keep an eye on that pawn there. So f5, I believe, is the beginning of of the downfall here. Now Carlsen played rook e1 here. Okay, already understanding that this pawn is going to be difficult to defend. So Aronian pushes it, and of course looking at it right away, looks like it should be okay, even though the pawn will become isolated because you have the knight here and the bishop here on g6. But watch how Magnus plays it. He takes, and now he just gets rid of the knight, so one of the protectors is gone. Rook takes e5, and now he just simply snatches the pawn. Knight takes e4. Okay, so just like that, Aronian is just down a pawn. So that's why I said f5 was definitely a mistake, because once the e pawn became weak, there was a wrap. So now the tides have completely turned, where it is Aronian who needs to switch to play in a dynamic style now. And usually when that happens, you're not mentally ready to just switch from, trying to get to an end game, trading off pieces, to all of a sudden now you have to play like a Tao in order to win the game. And this is what happens is Aronian is now in a position where he has to, create some dynamic counterplay in order to survive here. So if the knight takes e4, queen e5. So it's Aronian now. He has to keep pieces on the board, right? If he plays bishop takes e4, that's just basically getting out of the frying pan and going into the fire. That's no good. Just giving just examples right here. And just here already with these two rooks on the e file, like this black, excuse me, white is just dominating the board here. Rook soon is going to come to d6, hitting this and the queen. So queen e5 was played. Rook c3, rook c8, h3 is making some room there for the king just in case. And queen c7 was played. Rook takes c4 is risky because of the situation that the queen is in. If rook takes c4, then Aronian would have to part ways with the rook after knight d2. Queen takes d5, knight takes c4, queen takes c4, and then he would be down in exchange, and then it's easy to just trade the queens off, as you can see the queen being on the same diagonal as the king, and you would have a position that looks something like this, where white is just wrapping up. So he plays queen c7 here. Again, now the tides have turned, and it's black needing to keep the pieces on the board, etc., and try to play dynamic and heroically to save the position. Just being down a pawn, and that d pawn is a monster too. So knight d2, rook e8. Magnus just squeezes, man. That rook to e7 is deadly. Just taking over the file. This game is pretty much over here. Rook takes e7. Queen d8, better move, more dynamic move would have been queen f4, just trying to stay alive here, at least attacking something. Play could have followed queen c3, bishop f7, and then of course white is the one that would be trying to trade at this point. And then again, on to a winning endgame. But instead, Aronian played queen d8. And here, Magnus makes I can't even call it. It's not even an error. Like, he just makes a weaker move than he could have made. He plays queen e3, which is just a perfect, good natural move. Maintains the pressure here. Doubles up on the e file. Still winning. So there's nothing wrong with that. Stronger move is d6 here, which basically frees the queen from the responsibility of the rook. With the idea of, say, rook c5, right, breaking the coordination here. Now queen b2, and then now white would start harassing black on the king side. So bishop f7, queen d4, transferring over to f4 is the idea. And now this bishop is threatened. Bishop g6, d7, hitting the rook. Say the rook comes to, let's just say, c7, then queen e5, and that's pretty much all she wrote. The queen would have to sacrifice itself. If the queen tried to come here or something, you could just kamikaze with the rook. Rook takes g7, queen takes, and then just hit hard with another queen. But queen e3 was played, rook c7, Magnus again could have played a move like queen e6 here. Instead, he played rook e6, and he just got the job done. Rook c5, and then queen b3, and Aronian had enough. So good solid game by Magnus. Plus, he had said he was tired yesterday. Again, Magnus is just showing his class in his form. A question that I want to ask everybody that I asked on the forums is, what player or what world champion do you think outdistanced his contemporaries the most during his career? So we see right now that Magnus Carlsen has a pretty huge gap between, the number two player in the world and, his contemporaries in general. Nobody's really even close to Magnus right now. Like, if we had to take a poll, who can beat Magnus in a match? I mean, I don't see anybody beating the guy. So now we're just talking about distance between him and his contemporary. So who do you think was more dominant in their era? And the Carlsen era is still going, but I'm saying if you could stop the clock right now, how would you compare Carlsen's dominance over his peers to, say, Bobby Fischer's dominance? Kasparov's dominance over his peers. His closest number two was Karpov for a very long time, but then beside that, it was really, a big gap for a long time until the younger generation caught up. And then, of course, you can go way back to Paul Morphy. Ben Feingold does a good presentation on why he thinks Morphy is the best player of all time, and it's based on that criteria of the gap between or the dominance over your contemporaries. It's hard to disagree with the argument on Morphy, but again, I would like to hear from you guys and what you guys think about Magnus Carlsen's dominance as compared to the rest of the great chess players over their contemporaries. So I hope you enjoyed this video. Please like and subscribe, and I'll see you guys soon on the next one.